Okay, I'd like to call the October 27th Plymouth Village Water and Sewer District meeting to order.
Except, excuse me, that is the 25th.
It is the 25th.
Yeah.
So you might want to fix that.
No, I mean, you know why? That was my late sister's birthday. So I think I just...
Accidentally.
I think I did, yeah.
All right, I need a motion for minutes, please.
I will make a motion that we approve the October 11 meeting minutes.
I'll second that. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. No public. Manifest and payroll. I need a motion.
I'll make a motion that we approve the manifest and payroll as presented.
I second that. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right, if you want to sign.
Sure.
And dated the 25th.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Sorry about that. I'm sure it was just a Freudian something or other. Sibling birthday recognition.
I already signed that one, so this goes with us.
Yes.
Somehow. I'm not sure why there isn't a sticky on this. Do we need to sign this one?
Yeah.
There wasn't a sticky. Oh, there's the sticky.
Oh, good.
Okay. Jeez, it's all sticky.
What did we do before they had those things?
We actually looked.
Kitty cornered them.
To actually read. Great.
And you off cantilevered them like that.
Right.
A whole lot of
what Chris said about the engineering, and then
yes.
you referred me to the below contracts that you just sent me.
The previous email I sent you on.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. It didn't come in. No, but I looked at it when I came in here.
Okay.
I gotta be careful. They are. Maybe that didn't go through because of the size of the attachments.
Could be, yeah.
But I printed them.
Do you just want me to leave the pile here?
Sure.
Okay. Did we get it? Everything?
You got that.
That was the one.
This was the one that.
The one with the missing. That was the missing the sticky. Okay.
Missing bent beyond belief sticky.
All right. Okay. I'm listening.
Well, we have a new business. Would you like to make the announcement?
Oh.
You have the official announcement. I have the official announcement that it says, Dear Jason, from the New England Water Environmental Association, it is my privilege to notify you that you have been selected as recipient of the 2016 New England Water Environmental Association Operator Award for New Hampshire.
Congratulations.
This is given annually to a person involved in the operations of wastewater treatment facilities in each of the six New England states. The purpose of this award is to recognize an individual who has shown a high level of interest and performance in wastewater operations and who has made significant contributions to the wastewater field. And all I can say is, we've got you and we're so glad. Congratulations. This is awesome. And I'm assuming you're going to the luncheon?
Yes.
If it wasn't already. When was this dated?
13th.
No, the 13th? Luncheon's in January.
January? Yeah. Oh, good. You get to drive down in the snow.
Is it in Boston?
Yes.
Yeah.
Nice.
You can actually take the bus, probably.
Yeah, probably could.
Want to.
That's great.
Yeah.
Thank you.
We need to bring that. Do you get a thing?
Yeah, I'll be getting an award plaque, yeah.
Nice. That is very, very cool.
And if you want to stay overnight for this conference, the district will afford the money for you to do that.
Yes. We will do that.
Yes, we will. That's a private joke that we're not going to talk about out loud.
Okay.
But we'll tell you later.
Okay.
Yes. We will be glad to do that.
Okay. I appreciate it. Thank you.
Okay. So... Now you're on the hot seat, now that you've gotten that nice award, to talk about the budget and capital improvement plans and all that good stuff.
Maybe you want to start by going through the CIP.
That's what I was just going to suggest. Let's.
And everybody's got theirs.
I made copies.
We were good.
Figures for both water and sewer.
These are the copies of the maps.
And the maps, so we can actually see what we're talking about.
Oh, that's awesome. This is from our new...
Good, because I...
This is from our new system, right?
Visualize.
Our new GIS, who is it?
Yes.
Oh, this is so cool.
Collect, what's it called?
Collector.
Collector.
Yep, ArcGIS Collector.
Okay. So sewer or water first?
We can kind of do both because,
Fancy schmancy.
We're, kind of coattailing, each other on some projects. Some projects will be separated, depending on the specific area.
No pun intended.
I guess we could start on the figure one here, which you'll see on your water CIP and your sewer CIP as the South Main Street, project. From Highland Street to Winter Street intersection with Warren.
They're familiar with that piece.
Yeah, we happen to know that one.
And by the way, the engineering's probably not gonna start. It's gonna start next year for that. You had asked me about the timetable.
Well, it started now. The preliminary engineering report has started. But the actual design...
The design.
Won't be till early next year.
That's what I meant. So we won't know about costs or alternatives for...
Yeah, well, that was my...
A number of months.
Yeah, that was my question because I felt like that was important for us to be getting to the town so that they understand.
So it'll be a while.
We began the surveying phase of it and that's where we're at right now. We're hoping to complete that and get some more additional information off to the surveyor by the end of this week.
Oh, I thought that was... Okay, so that's not done yet?
No. Mm-hmm. We actually had to go in camera the sewer line to find the actual blind tied service connections.
Mm-hmm.
So we had a professional company come out to do that. And
what do you mean by blind tied?
So if a sewer main is running down a road and the service comes in to the main, not in a structure, you can't really see where it is unless you have ties to it. Correct.
For a larger...
For a junction, but if it's just a...
So typically now any new building that would be going in that would be significant flow, we would require a new manhole for the tie-in to the main.
Right, makes sense.
For instance, the new dormitory going in. Yeah. So in this case, a lot of the older businesses along the road are tied into the main at places where we can't see from above ground. So the only way to see it is actually to go in the in the line with the camera.
Any residents would be that way also, right? I mean,
most of them, yeah.
Right.
Unless they're doing a whole new main, like on Fairgrounds Road, when they did that main, most of us have our own little private manhole.
Right, and most of those we have records, tie records to the actual stub outs for each property. Whereas here we don't.
Okay.
So that their camera had, we started this last Monday and their camera had failed by the time we got down to Crawford Street. So they are coming back on Thursday to finish the rest of it.
And this is information you still have to get to Kevin French?
Correct.
Okay.
Yep.
And I know surveyors are busy, so, you know, it's going to take them some time to process all of this, right?
But this is the last piece to the puzzle. We have mostly everything else already surveyed, what Kevin had done back in the summer.
Good.
So it's just a matter of getting this to him, and he would be all set to go to submit it to Wright Pierce, and they can begin their preliminary engineering report to obtain USDA funding, which is a deadline by the end of December.
Oh, okay. So we'll have something by the end of December then.
Correct.
Okay.
Well, that's good.
Yeah.
Silly question.
Sure.
There's this nice space in sewer. What is that?
That is a... It is a space indeed, and the sewer...
It just stops there.
Yeah, it does.
From the southern portion of Main Street actually goes down Railroad Square
So it's
okay.
Right at the corner of the Napa building is right there, and that's where it goes down that little alleyway. Down back, and then the northern portion actually flows north towards the intersection of Highland and Green Street.
Okay.
Goes down from there.
All righty. Gotcha. Thank you.
And in the beginning component, when we started cameraing the line from the intersection of Warren and Winter down to Crawford, actually they call it PVC, but it actually looks like it was lined once before, so it could be asbestos cement pipe.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the.
So hazard mitigation.
I was just going to ask about that.
Potential. There's potential there.
Of course, there is.
You might have to abandon in place. And then offset from
it. Yeah. Because if it's abandoned in place, then it gets buried and you don't have to worry about it. Right?
And
right.
Northern Pass will have to dig it up.
So.
Okay.
So that's that.
I thought it was funny.
And we do have the funding for both water and sewer for this from previous fiscal years, so.
We have the authority to borrow, we haven't borrowed yet.
Yep.
Right. Okay.
And we'll also be applying for USDA ID grants for that.
Right. So that's grant funding. I forget with all the GRs and the Bs.
The GR would be grant funding. And then
B is bond, right?
Yeah, this one, I'm not even sure, since we appropriated the money already, if it's probably not on the plan, the CIP. Is it, Jason?
It's on,
yep.
Page 3.
Yeah, it's notated in there.
Okay.
Yeah.
Got it. Okay.
All right, so then we'll go on to...
GR, right, that's great.
Figure 2. And we'll start with water. Figure 2 on water is the Foster Street feed line replacement, and that is slated for 2017.
So that goes from the wells?
Yeah, Jason, are you focusing on 2017's projects in this presentation tonight?
No, I have.
You going further?
I have all of them. I can focus on 2017.
Well, in the interest of time, either we need to skip a long one, we need to just focus on the 17s.
I figured 17 would be all we need to really talk about tonight. We can
budget discussion.
Sure. So this is a 2017 Foster Street feed replace, like you said, Judy. It's all the way from the wells out to the actual intersection down in the intercourse behind the behind the building here, right across the river.
Right.
And that's where we have our valves in there that are gated off to either feed north towards Fairgrounds Road or south towards Old North Main Street line. And during this project, we will be installing two new meter pits in the Foster Street compound that will have new what they call mag meters, one for each well, whereas right now we have one meter, an old style Venturi meter in a pit, so that we can only actually see the flow from one well at
a time.
Yeah.
Yep.
So this will allow for
I'm assuming that's what the big blue P's are.
Yep, the P's are both the well sites.
Okay.
Yeah.
And the meter pits would be somewhere
in the yard there in the driveway. So that's part of this upgrade as well as the SCADA upgrade in electrical this year. So we do have some funding to purchase those meters.
Those are the big projects for 17.
And then we also have we're starting the planning of a few other projects. So if you go to figure 7 on the sewer side.
So just to relate it back, I mean, you have your budgets in front of you, but the Foster Street main replace feed is an item proposed for 17 at $150,000 in the budget.
Okay.
In your other document, Chris.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And that doesn't count the well improvements.
Correct.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
That's
separate.
Yeah. That's the bigger number. Okay.
Yeah,
so figure 7 in the sewer CIP map here.
7.
Shows the replacement of pump station 1 force main.
Yeah.
This one?
This one here. Yeah.
And that's phase 3 of the force main projects.
So that's phase 3 of what's coming up from Burger King?
So, yeah, if we go to...
I don't know, I tried to tell you that. Yeah. That's good.
Right.
I wasn't sure all the details. Yeah, so...
It's 2019 is that one. Yeah, we're kind of going off track here, but figure 3 is actually phase 3 of the force main 4 project.
Now...
And is that budgeted for 17?
The initial design of
would
it
be,
is.
The design,
yeah,
okay.
Because that would be in conjunction, yep, for 2019.
Okay, so.
Is the design in the budget?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, I got questions, of course.
Sure.
When we had spoken to Wright Pierce, I thought there was some consideration of not doing the rest of it depending on how the original fixed things.
Mm-hmm.
And then there was a whole bunch of talk about different relocation spots and all of this stuff.
Right.
We had about 60 maps I thought we were dealing with I think we had, what, 3, maybe 4 different options of mm-hmm. which was the best way to go, if we even needed to go.
But was this a resizing of this of the main here? Or?
No, this would be the same size, but it would be a realignment. So instead of going up through the ball field and up down Merrill and up Emerson to Highland,
yes.
It would go more of a flatter line cross country.
Right.
Over to here.
So we don't impact the fields of the school and
the streets.
The streets, etc.
And it would essentially be an energy saver for pump station 4. We can potentially downsize the pumps there. We've had a lot of issues with those pumps in the last 10 years.
So yep.
Right.
So that would be something as well that we would take a look at.
All right. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay.
So the design of this is in the budget, and the
actual
we would do it in 19.
Yes.
Okay.
So then if you look back at number 7, which would be in conjunction with that, figure 7 shows the force main from 1, then goes to gravity, pretty much all the way down to the plant. That line would be evaluated and mm-hmm. taken a look at
mm-hmm.
to determine the appropriate size for that realignment.
Okay. Now...
Relocation to Main Street. What? Where is it
currently? Currently, it's
adjacent
to the river.
Oh.
On the side of the railroad grade.
Yeah. Oh, I didn't know there's enough room in there. Really?
It's very tight.
I imagine.
This section of line in particular, we're not able to maintain right now because we can't drive a Vactor truck on the railroad bed to actually clean the line out.
Without major permitting and all of that to get on
there. So the existing line is on the riverside?
I can't imagine there's enough room there because it's pretty steep.
So potentially looking at either moving it adjacent to Main Street or even in Main Street in order to facilitate proper maintenance of that line.
Right.
Now, the Green Street line, this would just come down, kind of zigzag across the
right at the intersection of Bridge Street there, kind of
zigzag and down in. Okay.
Yeah.
So this 2350 feet, that needs to be replaced, or that section that's in red is just going to be evaluated?
It's going to be evaluated to determine if it's appropriate size
for the flow that would be coming in.
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah.
Got it.
So, essentially that would be taking flow out of the Main Street area, Highland Street line, and moving it, moving it to this line.
Okay. I just, maybe I missed something, but this is the sewer line we intend to replace with South Main?
No, it's a little bit deceiving.
Yeah, it's not.
Flip back and forth between 1 and 7. I think it'll make it clearer what the distinction is.
There's definitely a...
This is Green Street line.
Oh, are we
it's
done?
A the map is at Green Street? Yeah, the map is at a different scale.
Okay, yeah, it's at a different scale, so you can't really see Main. Oh, here's Main Street up here. Yep. Thank you, thank you. Makes more sense.
Yep. I looked at that twice I thought we were talking about
Main Street there.
Yeah.
Well, we are talking about Main Street north of Bridge Street.
Okay, gotcha. Yeah. Gotcha.
And then, like I said, it zigzags into
Right, there is
Bridge.
No Green Street. Gotcha. All right. Yeah. Well, yeah, it's hard to see on this map, but I got...
It is a confusing one, but it's...
So on the CIP, that would be this, the third one down on page 3, which is the 17 to 19... water, and then 17 to 19 sewer.
Yeah.
Because we've got all sorts of things in here. All right, I found it. Ouch. These numbers are big.
Under pump stations?
I got it. No, below that.
Under main
sewer main replace?
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, 7 million.
Yeah, I know. I'm looking at these numbers going, ow.
Yeah.
Yep, so essentially the 2017 will be $30,000 for both water and sewer for the pre-planning grant for U.S. Rural Development.
Okay.
Yeah.
30 and 30?
Yes.
In the sewer budget?
In the...
What do you mean?
Yeah, 30 in the water and 30 in the sewer.
All right.
And then, let's see. I think that does it for sewer projects for next year.
Okay.
Yeah. Water alignment is figure 10 is the actual water alignment along the same route.
Where's that 30 that corresponds in the water bucket? This? Main Street from Fall?
Yep, PPG grant.
Oh, thanks.
Yep.
I'm going to have to asterisk this thing so we know what we're talking about, right?
This gets complicated now.
Yeah, it
now,
does get complicated.
So yeah, that goes pretty much from the valves across the river here,
all the way down.
Down Old North Main, actually crosses up to Toby, and then down Week Street, and then down Pearl Street, and then back to Main Street, which is the current alignment as well for the water.
Okay. Why wouldn't we keep it all on Main?
That's the current alignment, and I believe there is, I believe there's some ledge in there that in the past that they had.
I think that's probably true.
They had evaluated it, and that this was the best route to avoid it.
I think you're right.
A ledge on Main, North Main?
Yes, on Main. This whole section is ledge, so we went up.
Is that possibly the reason that the existing line is running on the opposite side of the tracks?
It could be as well.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's something we're going to take a look at.
Right.
Yeah.
Didn't the college just rip up Week Street? Or the town, so we're full width roadway reconstruction again.
Yeah, but that would be till 19.
Right. Okay.
Yeah.
By then, I will need it.
Did they do Weeks or Toby? Or both?
They did Week Street.
Week Street.
Yeah. Or Steam.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And they did a lot of blasting in there as well. So this would be a replacement in kind. So I would assume that the trench would be there.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Same location. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So if you live on Weeks, you get a new road every couple of years.
You get all that disruption.
We're far longer than that on fairgrounds for
And it's something we're trying to work closer with the university as well on that.
Yeah.
To try to work together on these projects and take their needs into account as well.
Of course,
so.
Yes. Right, yeah. Right. Can you make some general comment? Just, I think it's always important to be reviewing this with an eye towards the necessity for this. I mean, we are spending a lot of money here, and I've had some discussion with Mel about, you know, we're taking on a lot, you know, a lot of spending a lot of money here in the coming years, and
right.
I'm sure anybody watching, you know, over this would say, geez,
yep, ouch,
you know, how are you going to pay for all of this? And you know, there are two classes of changes that we would be making. One are, you know, essential to keep the water flowing and the sewer working,
mm-hmm.
and then there are others that, you know, that, you know, they're a lot more ambiguous benefit. So I'm sure some people would want to hear, like myself, that, you know, how does this all fall?
Sure. Yeah, this particular water project is bringing it out to 16 inch, and currently it is 10 inch.
Okay.
So there's a hydraulic deficiency in this line.
Okay.
As well as this is pretty much our feed line as well. So we're continuing with our coming out of Foster Street. This is one of the main feed lines to our tank.
And does it impact fire protection?
Yes.
In terms of need. But one thing Chris and I were talking in here a couple of days ago, or at least yesterday, and we've had other discussions about it too. We have some money in capital reserve for various projects. Not anywhere near as much as we would propose to spend if we did all these projects. You know, this is just something to think about. Would we be smart to get some sort of a economic or financial expert to look at factors like income of our user base?
I thought that was part of what was in the Water Master Plan already.
Well, I think the Water Master Plan could spend a lot of money. I mean, at what point, how much money can we borrow and carry that, have users carry that weight into 30 or, I mean, we did some modeling last year, which didn't.
Which was a helpful start, I think.
It was a helpful start.
To get an order of magnitude, at least,
but
of what we're up
against. If we do all these things, and if we pay for it by borrowing, even if we have 25 or 45% grant funding, if mm-hmm. we're lucky, how far can we go? What's the breaking point? Right now, our users support our projects, and they understand the importance, and I think they have, you know, confidence in you. But as Chris said, you know, at what point does somebody come in and say, this is too much, and vote, you know, start voting no on bond issues, which we don't want to happen. I'm just throwing that out there. I don't know that it's necessary. I think we, you know, we're pretty deliberate in how we choose to do things, but, you know, we can all see down the road, and I'm sure you worry about it as I do. You know, how can we finance it?
Right.
Yeah, we haven't even talked about the next 5 years. I mean, fortunately we're putting aside a lot of money for what
for
are really essential
projects.
Yeah,
yep.
essential projects that we have to undertake to really to maintain services.
I mean, deferred maintenance just means more expensive to do it later, or it means a break, and we, you know,
we've been there, done that.
We don't want to do that, particularly with sewer.
Right, a lot of these projects were prioritized as well based on the risk associated with them.
Right.
A lot of the projects in the Main Street area, if there's a large break or failure there, there'd be huge business exposure risk.
Right.
Not just business, but traffic as well.
And contamination if it's on the sewer side.
Right, so it's...
And potentially, I mean, it was 200 grand up here. I mean, it could be even more, I suppose, if it were.
In defense of all these projects, unfortunately, I sit here and go, when I look at them. But for too long, we kept deferring. And now we're to the point where we can't defer anymore.
We're paying the piper. I just wanted to say that, and we can all be thinking about it as we.
Well, yeah, I think it's something we have to weave into the discussion.
Yep. But I think it's good that we did that master plan, so we have an idea of what can wait until 2020, or, you know, what can even wait until 2025. But, you know, like Jason said, the ones we're prioritizing first are the really important
ones
because if not, we're going to be in trouble.
And especially Now, too, with Northern Pass coming through, we'd like to...
Well, we don't know that yet.
Maybe.
Potentially.
Potentially.
We'd like to have the design available so that we could say, this is where our line is going to be or is, and they can have that data to plan, to work with us, to potentially coexist, I guess, in the same area.
Plane.
Right. I think that's an important factor to have, that data to be able to provide to them.
Right. If they don't come through, we have our plan in place. If they come through, then we have our plan in place.
They can work around it.
That's why on these projects in particular, we're starting, it's a 2 to 3 year phased approach. Mm-hmm. For the engineering and design.
Right, that way we don't get clobbered all the way in 1 year.
Yeah, well, I mean, I guess that brings up an important question. I mean, with regard to possibly moving the sewer line here on North Main Street onto North Main Street from the railroad grade, if we have that at least in the design phase, are you saying that we have a first claim to the...
I don't know.
I mean, it's Northern Pass. Yeah. If they say we're going through, then we have to work around...
Good point. I don't know who trumps.
We would be working with them to try to
avoid conflict.
To make sure that our setbacks from each other's lines are appropriate.
Right.
And you know, whether it's 10 feet one way, 10 feet the other way, it does have a significant impact on where we can put the line and where they can put the line.
Well, of course, another concern is it going to add cost for us if...
Right, exactly.
If, for example, on North Main, they put in a line, then we're subject to their setback. You know, is that suddenly adding money onto our project?
Possibly? Sure, the potential exists there, absolutely.
I mean, it's probably hard to say, but is there enough room for... I mean, if Northern Pass does come through, are they blocking enough of the... with their required setback... is that really going to limit what we do outside of our... You were talking about the need to possibly abandon a line in place on South Main. So, you know, we've got to move over from that. So at some point it gets too crowded to be working there.
Yeah, there's no extra room on South Main Street.
Right.
I can imagine, yes.
Curb to curb. Yeah,
that's why we're upping our efforts in the engineering and surveying of these projects. While they're actually working on their own surveying right now.
And probably possibly engineering, preliminary engineering.
So it is my hope that there comes to a point when they're complete and we're complete that we can sit down together and go through the entire route that will be affecting us and them.
Mm-hmm.
To try to hash it out.
Because the last thing you want to do is put new water lines in and have them come in and say... our stuff is going to get buried here. These water lines have to be moved.
Well, can they?
It seems
and
to
can
me
they do that?
We need to know what's going to happen with Northern Pass before we proceed down South Main Street or even North Main.
But the point to have a design is so that we can compare.
Have a design. Yeah.
Yep.
Because that.
And find those areas that potentially will be an issue.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yeah. So is that it for 17's actual cash outlay, or you
got more? That's it for 17's actual road projects.
Okay.
So we can move on to.
This is great. Having these maps.
Yeah, I can't imagine
trying to
have a meaningful discussion of this without these figures.
Yeah, and learning that the sewer line is on this side of the railroad tracks going that way.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, there was a reason they put it there, I would think.
Oh, I'm sure I think it is ledge.
It was a lot more work to go there than it.
Sure.
And I think it was ledge.
Yes, right.
Okay. I'm thinking it was ledge because if you think about that hill is there because
of ledge.
Of ledge.
Yeah.
There's ledge sticking out on both sides. That's true. Which they're probably finding when they do their survey work.
I'm sure they are.
Past people.
So if you want to go to the water CIP, we can go through a few more.
There's more.
But wait, there's more.
There's always more.
So you'll see.
Do you want them to look at the detailed sheets or the summary?
Yeah, we can go through the detailed sheets would be fine.
But is everything on there? I don't think everything's on.
No, I don't think it is.
It's just where we had to really...
Yeah.
Play. It might be better to
go through the
summary, okay. And then if people want to get... I mean, because we've got pipe size and lengths on that. I think it's better for this to go through some.
Yeah.
So for fiscal year 17, we have an outlay of $18,000 for the Holderness property lease payment.
Right.
We have a reserve of $75,000 for the water storage tank replacement of the 2.5 million gallon tank. We have $21,000 for water vehicle and heavy equipment.
And these are deposits into
yes.
Capital. Yep. And for details on that, you can look at the detailed worksheet.
Mm-hmm.
For $30,000 will be reserved going into water distribution and emergency repair fund. $5,000 for water pump and motor repair fund.
Doesn't seem like enough, but...
No, but...
That seems pretty small compared to what we've been spending.
Mm.
Right.
But we just replaced them, so that's...
I see.
So starting.
Rebuilding.
Yep. Then we have $30,000 for an asset management grant, $15,000 matching grant, which is a continuation of what we are doing this year.
Yep,
that's we gross budget mm-hmm. and get yep. money reimbursed.
We have $385,000 for Foster Street well improvements, including the chemical room, demoing
the old... recommended by...
Yep.
Barry Miller,
yeah.
And we hadn't seen
that. Wright Pierce, yeah, in the master plan.
That's Owies.
So yeah. Demoing the old building and adding the new meter pits.
Okay.
So that gives us greater flexibility, as you alluded to a little while ago, about blending.
Commingling, yeah.
Commingling water from the two pump, mm-hmm. the two wells.
We'll yeah. be able to accurately determine how much is coming from each one.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
Let's see. Then we have $50,000 going into reserve for water zone meters.
Oh yeah, $50,006. We got $6 interest on last year's deposit.
I was going to say that's such a weird number.
Yeah, it's those are balances as of October, ish.
1.2%. Yahoo.
I know. Well, helps if the money gets in the buckets timely.
Then we have...
Water main replacement?
Yep, we just went through the water main replacements.
Okay. So that's that $180,000?
Yep, so that's it for the water side. And we'll go on to the sewer CIP. So we have an outlay of $135,000 and a reserve of $60,000. For the wastewater treatment plant expansion and upgrade, and those details are found on the detail worksheet. It includes south garage roofing, sludge building, furnace, headworks, gas detection metering, lime silo cone replacement, and scum trough and telly valve replacement.
Just growl about that one.
Yeah, right.
Now, see, we have $285,000 in trust.
Yes, I see that.
So we can decide how to fund
right.
the 135 and whether we want to put 60 in. I mean, that...
Right. We can finagle around yeah. with those numbers a little bit.
The 60 is there. You see a combination of chains, flow meters, shaft replacements, and clarifier wall bearings. Sorry, not clarifier wall bearings, but that would be it for the 60,000. We have...
Wait, you... See... When we do this, we have a sort of like a detail struggle. I want to know what amount of money might be going into capital reserve for these general purposes.
Right,
and
right.
then Jason likes to list out all the
all the fun details. Things you're going to do.
Yeah, all the things. Yes, exactly. Yep. So
then we have, next on the list is $30,000 outlay for asset management on the sewer side.
Yeah.
And that is 100% principal forgiveness.
Mm-hmm.
So unlike the $15,000 matching on the water side, we'll develop our sewer side GIS
cool.
to accompany the water.
So again, we outlay, they pay back.
We still yes. have to spend it, yeah.
Yes.
Right.
And yeah. we have been, I've actually been piggybacking what we're doing in the water side right now, working with Wright Pierce on the sewer side, so we are ahead of the game on the sewer side, so by the time we get into this, we'll be able to further develop.
Great.
The sewer.
At the end of last year, remember, Chris Berg wanted us to apply for this, and I couldn't find the authority to do it, or the outlay appropriation, mm-hmm. So this way we have it. We'll have it right in the budget.
Okay.
Then we have $22,000 for wastewater vehicle and heavy equipment reserve. We have $5,000 in reserve for collection system emergency repair. $6,000 for reserve for collection system pump and motor emergency repair. We have $4,000 in reserve for wastewater treatment plant emergency pump machine and machine repair. We will have an outlay of $156,000 for pump stations, and those are on the detailed list as well, mm-hmm. to include pump station 8 generator replacement, pump station 4, sorry, not pump station 4, pump station 1 improvements, and that's part of the realignment of pump station 4 force main. And the
isn't about $150,000 for the generator?
$156,000
generator replacement would be $6,000.
Oh,
yeah. $150,000 would be for pump station one improvements.
I see. Okay, that's yeah. That's
the detail. And you know what? Let me. While I'm thinking of it, our grant funder, USDARD, and you may remember this, when we go through the letter of conditions with our representative, this is what mm-hmm. you know you're on the hook for. They had a new requirement this year, as Chris and I sat here with them, and we are now required, or at least they want us to, put a debt service reserve, like in a capital reserve, debt service reserve of $44,000, and that's based on a formula, and also short-lived asset replacement of $38,579, which some of the short-lived asset replacement may be in our trust now, so I'm not sure. If, you know, do we not fund something by putting money into capital reserve? But we put
so they're just coming up with these figures. We have to kind of map those to the individual.
Or have a new capital reserve account that's called these two things. That would be the cleanest. And then either we fund, like, say, what's a short-lived asset?
Something that you're replacing within 5 years.
Yeah, right. Yeah. But like a pump, or I'm trying meters? To think of even.
Yeah, it would be meters. Yeah.
Okay, meters. So instead of putting
X amount of dollars into our meters, we
just
could
put
that into that short-lived asset,
right? Okay. Something like that.
Yes.
So it's just moving the money
right,
from.
This will make our funders happy if we comply with this.
Okay. Well, we would like to. Let's comply.
It's
with
like.
It.
Right.
It's the shell game.
Right,
we
yes.
And debt service reserve is to make sure that we can
pay our debts, of course.
So I just want to throw that out because that is not in the budget yet. I just went
okay.
through
right. it's just,
paperwork.
This is just a okay. formality.
And then the,
it is. It's moving money around.
Then we had the last one on the sewer capital was $30,000 for sewer main replacement, and that was for the pre-planning grant.
Yes, dokie. Okay, so then, is it budget or is it rates and fees?
No, it's budget next.
Budget next.
And then we can do fees.
Speed it up!
But it's more fun looking at pictures and fees.
Like a budget?
Actual budget, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I haven't had one since you guys plugged
one
under. Yeah, just to see a CFP one.
Oh, that's good. So sorry.
That's
right.
This is the one we got on the 11th.
Small poop. Yeah, we haven't.
This one.
We haven't changed it since the last meeting. Do you want to start with that? I'll make a copy of this for you. I made the board bring this back, so I didn't make a copy.
You made one of the board members remember to bring it back, but the other didn't.
What?
Let me go.
No. I brought the CIP. Yes. I thought that was my instructions. I can look at what.
Okay, we can share.
Yes.
All right. I'm gonna make sure.
Don't waste the paper.
So I guess we'll start off with questions. If you guys had any questions after you reviewed.
I don't think I had any questions really. The budget was pretty straightforward. We talked with Mel about it last time, right? I don't think there was anything major in here that. I guess my only question would be, are we still attempting to get that assistant for you?
Oh, yeah, that's a good question.
Yes, we are.
How are we doing on that?
Recruiting efforts have been...
slim to none?
Very slowed down to almost a stopped point. I've exhausted most of my resources, and the word is out there. So it's just a matter of finding that person that we can... You know, get kind of warm up to and get to come here. So it's.
Do we want to put out feelers farther afield, New York?
The only other thing would be to do is to change the position.
And that's what I was going to ask too. Are we asking just too much about what this position is expecting?
I don't feel that we are, but.
We can't find the person to actually fit that bill. Right. Okay.
So that might be the other option is to potentially look at our other positions and determine if we can determine if the needs can be met by having maybe multiple people for that role.
Okay.
So that would be
presumably the need for this person or persons is going to come around again when spring hits, right? I
mean, right.
So if we're going to make some changes, then
think about
do that first of the year, right?
Yeah. The question was on the position, yeah.
Yeah.
So to potentially reassess
whether we should position, budget for it or not, yeah.
Well, to reassess the actual position. If the duties are more than or
what you guys are able
what
to find.
We're able to find potentially.
I think it's the certification that we can't find. The grade 3 qualification.
Yeah. Which, can we do a grade 2 with the intent to become a grade 3?
Yeah, that's the way it's written now is grade 3 or the ability to obtain it within 1 year.
Within a year, how likely is that depending on when they get hired?
You have two chances.
You have two chances, okay.
Third chance, you're three strikes, you're out.
All right. I also mentioned maybe going a little farther afield, like maybe looking at somehow advertising in Connecticut or Rhode Island or New York.
Massachusetts.
That's the hard thing about New Hampshire is the wastewater licensure is not reciprocal to another state, nor is other states reciprocal to New Hampshire.
We got a number of people who applied, one of whom was qualified, and we invited him to have a telephone interview with us, and he backed out. Mm-hmm. And he was in Western Massachusetts, I believe.
Well, Virginia, right?
He was in Virginia, yeah. That's right. Because we put it on the website Indeed, mm-hmm. Joshua told us about. Most of the applicants had nowhere near the qualifications. I mean, you know.
That's why we were talking about maybe tweaking the qualifications a little bit.
I mean, they weren't even in the same ballpark, you know, mm-hmm. restaurant right. people and just.
I want to go there.
Yeah.
Okay.
So
you want to evaluate it when or?
Soon.
Right, I mean, if
he needs to hire, we need to look at this.
Well, we need to have it either in the budget or not, right?
Right.
Yeah. Well, it needs to be in the budget. Okay. I think there's no.
So leave the money in the budget and figure out what the role might be.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah, definitely.
Okay.
Yeah, and Jason just asked whether or not we had questions on the budget, and I don't think we really did. We kind of went over it a little bit with you last time. And
there aren't, now that we've got a couple of years under our belt, and you do.
Yeah.
There aren't any surprises here. We have
nothing was.
No, and we even cut a couple of things by $100. If any of our overhead costs were budgeted too high, then we're knocking it back a little bit, and we're trying to be responsible.
We did one of the big things we did this year that will have an effect on that next year is the use of
water,
fuel oil at the plant.
Water or sewer?
Sewer.
Okay.
We're no longer using number two fuel oil. We're using propane now.
Okay, so that'll be.
So we're anticipating a cost savings potentially there.
Okay.
Due to the efficiency of the equipment we have now.
Nice.
That's a bigger thing, but for example, our workers' comp went down.
Yeah.
A little bit because we've got such a great record, but our unemployment compensation is up.
Yeah.
Due to circumstances.
And, you know, we know that we have to wait until we get the rates and stuff for health insurance, dental insurance,
and we just got it the other day, so they're not.
And you told Cindy not to worry about it. Yep.
Just, we'll do it in.
Yeah.
So she has a good time to do
but
it.
But you said health insurance was going up slightly, dental insurance is not changing, so that's good.
8.1%.
Health insurance. Yeah, right.
Better than
but because of
care.
The
yes, it's not terrible.
Because of the composition of our staff, we're actually down two-person plan to a one-person plan, so that's cost savings there. We'll recompute with the new rate. So
All right.
It probably will counterbalance the 8.1% not having a two-person plan.
All right. I was fine. I mean, I looked this over before the meeting, so I didn't really have any questions. So I'm good.
And like Mel said, I just want to double that, is that we are getting more comfortable with it now. So I think the numbers are, you know, not going to change much. We know what we need to spend and what line items that we're spending out of.
And nobody's just like randomly making things up?
Nope.
I like it.
Nope. I mean, this is a budget we lived with over this last year. And
okay. I'm good. Yay. Cool.
You should have higher expectations, Judy. So you should have higher expectations of us.
She does. She's
making jokes.
Yeah, we throw darts at your picture all the time when you're not.
She's having a joke from the past.
Notice my thing about the award. We've got you and we're not letting you go. Thank you.
Yes.
The award is obviously well deserved.
So I'm going to come back to you with this, with the rest of the numbers on the 8th. So if anything does come up, you know, if we learn anything, we can point it out.
All righty. So then we've got
fees.
Yes.
Shall we
fee
chat
or not
about
the fee?
Water or sewer first?
Water first.
Water first. Okay.
I left you one on the table. Did you find it?
Yep.
The fees? I
like
it.
Got it.
You got it?
So we'll start with water first. I guess we can kind of go over both at the same time. A lot of them are.
Some of them are.
If you could just begin by just a general comment on process here.
Right.
How'd you pull a number out of a hat?
I mean, well, the first thing we did was I came back to you for guidance.
Yes, right. We had general discussion that we should be on par with.
On par with others. Yeah. Don't try to completely cover the cost, but offset it.
Yes.
And be reasonable about increasing things, taking into account how much time it takes. And,
yes.
And so basically that's, we just took that and Jason did first blush numbers for the most part, and then Kim and Jason and I sat down twice to arrive at these suggestions. And you know what, I'll tell you, we're happy if you want to scale them back or increase them. I don't think you'll want to increase them anywhere, but people do need more help than they think they need, and it takes our superintendent's time. Mm-hmm. And a lot of times there's multiple visits to sites. And
The only question I really have is the meter charge going up from $5 to $9 a quarter.
Well, all the others are the same. Mm.
That was based on the three-quarter meter.
That's most of us.
Right. And that was based on a recovery for that meter. So if you're on a 10 to 15 year meter replacement program, would be $9 a quarter, would equate to the actual cost of that meter for 10 years of quarter of collecting that fee.
Wow. Mm. Okay. Well, that answers that question.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we had, I mean, we at least had a discussion. We had due deliberation on each of these.
Yeah, no, that's the only one that really sticks out as being something that I think people would ask about because it affects most everybody. All of the others are very specific.
Well, there are also a number that do not change, but I mean, application fees.
Right.
Change, but I think that reflects more of that.
Right.
And you know, these haven't been increased since, I think, 07.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
One thing I'll point out on the engineering and legal review deposits.
Yeah, I noticed that any balance will be returned to the applicant, which is nice.
If there is a balance, I mean, it's always been like that, but some people gave us opinions that we have we have a deposit of $250, but their cost might be $2,000, and so they think, well, geez, that's your estimate. Well, it's not an estimate; it's just a minimum deposit. So we're raising that. We don't want to be in the business of giving money back,
right?
So I wanted to raise it, but keep it low enough so that it's always. Right. Otherwise, we'd have to budget for return of.
Right.
So we raised it to $500, and we're going to strengthen our explanation to applicants and put it right on the form that. This is just a deposit, and you will be billed for the remainder. It's not...
It's not a fixed fee.
Not expected to cover it.
Right. Okay.
And then, the other one that we discussed today actually was user fees for unmetered users.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We were looking at, where do we get the $86.34 for the water side? What's applicable to an unmetered user? How do we determine?
Most of our unmetered users are mobile homes and things like that, right? So we're usually looking at fairly low water
usage.
And we don't, for the mobile homes that are metered, do we have about an average of what's being used?
Right, that's what we talked about was taking the current rate and finding out the average use for domestic bill and then possibly putting a 25% surcharge on that just because we don't know an unknown factor.
Okay.
So that's something.
So that's still going to change.
Yeah, I mean, I guess there should be some incentive to install the meter because and
some
save money.
Right. Because of freezing.
Because they go snowbirds.
Oh, that's true.
Okay. Some of them we have that are actually metered on wells that we only take sewer from get sand in their lines and potentially clogs the meter up and added maintenance for us to go out there and clean it out. So,
Which you're right, it's not something we have to do, but if our meter's not running, then we just go.
We don't get money, so we have to go clean the meter.
I think that's kind of important there is to determine what percentage on top of the average we should charge because of that unknown factor. And Kim, Mel, and I discussed potentially 25% on top of that domestic average.
Okay.
So that would be something for consideration.
Roughly how many households have don't have meters?
Yeah. We have quite a few, I think.
There's quite a few. I'm not sure exact numbers, but we can find that out.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, it's not critical. Yeah. I was just curious.
She could get it for us.
Mm-hmm. But I mean, I would think that might also factor into your surcharge that you're thinking of.
Yeah.
Because that. Does that make it difficult for us to monitor our losses to?
Yeah,
that's another thing.
Well, that goes into the 15% of
The water loss. Yeah.
Because we don't
know exactly how much is being used.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's probably why 15% is acceptable. Not what we did have was 25%, but we're better. We're back down.
Mm-hmm. Oh, we've lowered that number.
Back, yeah. Mm. Because we changed the Continental, and we're capturing it better.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
And the meter, we're more aggressive on the meter replacements. Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah.
In the past couple of years.
I think in the first quarter, I'm not sure the second or third quarter yet. The first quarter, I had calculated around 5%.
Water loss.
Yeah, well, only 5% based on the numbers that Kim and I compared.
Down from 25%.
That's incredible.
From what was pumped to what was actually
billed.
Yeah.
Wow.
That is awesome.
That is great.
That is awesome.
I think that discussion we had this afternoon about
the actual. Was it on the Tenny Mountain recovery? The actual calculation?
Oh, yeah, we were curious what we... I kind of tried to talk to you about this last time, and I didn't really know what I was asking you. About the recovery charge for Tenny Mountain.
That was before me, okay. So I don't even have the institutional memory to tell you how that was done.
Okay, that's all right. That's fine.
I can tell you how Fairgrounds Road was done, but I can't tell you how this one was done.
Well, and if there are new connections, we charge it. It's a one-time.
Right.
Right. Well, I know. Yeah. I'm still learning this, too.
Yeah.
No, actually, I was thinking about... Jason's proposing for sewer, and maybe... Am I jumping ahead?
No.
Okay.
Yeah.
To have a residential... the basic charge, and then if you have... So to have different categories of
users, yeah.
Like if they have
based on their loading,
bad BODs, high BODs.
Yep.
High BODs. If they're discharging, what like a dairy, for example, would have high BODs, and so would you want to charge them 10% more than the basic? And I mean, this is all board decision. This is a recommendation to you. It would mean that. We'd have to identify which of our users falls under those various categories, and then we'd have to make software changes to accommodate those extra bills. But
so we're talking about the regular user fees, X amount plus.
For users that require us to spend more money to process the effluent what comes.
It would be essentially the strength of the wastewater would determine what category you'd be in, and if your wastewater is more than 250 milligrams per liter for BOD or TSS,
okay,
we'd charge you 10% of the actual base rate.
How more. Would we find out?
We would go around and test and survey so that we know what was being discharged.
It so could that be would kitchens. Be
all commercial. How do we decide who we would be testing?
It's part of the pre-treatment program.
Okay.
We'd go in and determine what the actual strength and characteristic of their wastewater is.
Wastewater is. Okay.
And then recommend potential
mitigation
for it. And if they'd have the option to either pay the higher rate
or mitigate it. That's a good idea. I don't find that.
If the cafeteria is grinding its food waste instead of separating it out of the waste stream.
Yeah. Right.
So the opportunity for mitigation is pretty clear. I mean, it's going to be restaurants are going to be
there. Sure, yeah. Just like the example Mel just used with food preparation, a lot of places have grinders in them
that grind
the food and the solids and the organic material just goes down the sewer. Whereas the solid should be separated out and thrown in the trash.
Or a compost pile.
Right, or a compost pile, yeah.
And so how...
And I'm surprised that with the Eco House and stuff like that, more of that is not happening on a college campus per se. But I wonder like what the hospital is doing as well for their food preparation, so...
Yeah, we've actually been working with the hospital and requested that they remove their grinding equipment. And they're proceeding to do that.
Oh, nice. That's
great.
That's awesome.
How about the high school?
The high school, I believe they still have it, but it's not in use as much anymore.
Yeah. So, you're going to have to monitor this? I mean, is this kind of, or is this...
Yep, it's part of the pre-treatment program, so...
Jay is responsible for it.
Yes.
Yep, so Jay and I have gone around, done a preliminary assessment, and we just want to offer this option.
I think it's a great idea.
Yeah.
I mean...
Well, it's an incentive to,
right,
to do things...
Right, it's an incentive to do things the right way.
Yes. And if it's not a...
And honestly, vegetable waste and things like that, there's so many other things you could do with it than flush it down the drain.
Things like that, and grease as well, so essentially...
Well, and I thought we most of our restaurants and stuff have that anyway, because we needed the fat, oil, and greases all taking fogs need to be taken care of.
Right.
But if we come in...
All those fogs.
If we start doing random sampling as well, we can, you know, potentially... find violators that aren't maintaining their systems properly, even though they have the
checks.
Even though they have the preventative devices in place.
If they aren't using them,
it
doesn't
maintaining
help.
Them.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's right. You were trying to figure out on Tenny Mountain who was
fogging up the works.
Yes. The past couple of months.
For pump station 4?
Yes.
Did you figure it out?
We have determined that it was Walmart that was ragging. They had excessive rags.
What were they doing? Probably the cleaning brush heads and just flushing them down the toilet?
We're not sure exactly what was going on there.
Has it stopped?
But we are, one of our newer operators, Dave, had fabricated a portable bar rack that we can put in manholes. So we've actually put a bar rack in each manhole.
Oh my God!
Station 4 back.
Where are we catching?
So you could see who was
actually discharging the rags.
Holy moly! Yeah. What a great idea!
So we've been
forensic.
He also built a nice platform for our new propane tank out behind the plant.
Yeah, forensic
and we've been,
sewer maintenance.
We had a few instances as well of floor stripper being discharged. Some folks at the Hatch Plaza and also up near the Boulder Point complex that
cleaning floors
were cleaning floors and dumping it. So we did delineate from there and determine those discharges as well.
Oops.
So we've been...
Now, when somebody does a bad oopsie, like chemicals going down the drain that definitely shouldn't be, do we have fines in place? Or do we just go over and say... don't do that again.
We'd rather have them comply.
Okay.
At this point, there are fines in place in the regulations.
Right.
But we haven't enforced any of those because those places have complied.
Well, that's what I was going to say. Yeah. You get a one-time
mistake.
Don't do this again, and then the second time,
plus
okay, we got to charge
you. We're strengthening our regulations.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
We're working on that.
So yeah, it is a. You know, a safety hazard for us.
Oh, yeah.
Because we don't know
what's
potentially
coming.
What's mixing or...
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. The vapor cloud that can...
So we'd rather not have it at all than...
Right,
be fine.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yes. Exactly.
Any other highlights on the sewer? And we can bring these back for your adoption next time.
The other one was...
Go ahead. Jason, go ahead. I'll
chime in.
Pick up.
We added a section for industrial discharge permit applications in three different classes. We have no industrial discharges in town, but it is a good idea to have something in place.
In case we do.
For the event that we do get an industrial discharger coming in, so we included those as well.
Oh, right, and the next one you want to talk to the board about this.
Septage?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, that was going to be my
mentioned
question.
It. Yeah.
So the septage fees... proposing keeping the town's with agreement the same as is, 7 cents.
There's a typo too. In the middle column, the disposal with towns with no agreements is actually 8.5 cents.
Oh,
and Kim just we found that this afternoon. Yeah. She forgot to fix it. It's 8.5. So it'd be down 0.5 cent.
0.5 cent. Yeah.
Okay. And the reason for going down?
Potentially gain more business from out-of-town areas. We have competing septage-receiving plants in the area that are as low as 6.5 cents. per thousand. So that's one situation where we are competing. We have a few haulers that do haul to the plant that has 6.5 cents, which is Allenstown, New Hampshire.
Yep.
So they'd actually go there for 6.5 cents from the area they're hauling from, and it is pretty much equal distance to where we are.
Oh, I see. Okay. Yeah. So to say that it's certainly not saving anything if they've got to factor extra fuel into the mix.
Right.
If it's equal fuel,
we're right. Still expensive.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. And equal time to pay the driver. But right. We talked about dropping it even more, but I wasn't sure that we wanted to drop it.
I think this is something.
Drop the towns with the agreement. You know, yeah. it's a combination. Yeah.
I think this is a good starting point. Okay. Once we get our new septage receiving in place, then we can reevaluate to determine the amount of septage we're getting in. If we need more, we do have a few places that have approached us that said, "Hey, we want to bring 7 or 8 thousand gallons per day every day."
Holy moly!
And presumably, this is a nominal BOD or you know, yep. It's not like
nominal BOD TSS.
Right.
We don't want all
right.
that nasty stuff.
Right. More of a holding tank, water type stuff. Yeah. We have been approached by Woodstock to take in sludge. Currently, they haul sludge to Franklin.
If they can do it to us, that is definitely closer for them.
Right.
A lot closer.
But that is a higher strength one.
So we'd have to charge them the higher rate unless they...
Potentially, yeah, unless we come into some agreement. So I've been doing a little research on this, and some of those type places want to have an agreement with you as well. So they want to have, you'll be able to take X amount.
Every day.
So they know.
So that they have a kind of a guarantee that that they can rely on us to take it.
Yeah.
A few of them are larger landfills up north, have leachate that they need to dispose of.
Oh, that scares me.
And they actually take most of it right now to Concord. So it would almost cut their trip in half, potentially, to come to us.
Yeah, it depends what's in the leachate.
Right. Correct. If there's industrial use in the town.
If it affects our waste going to RMI, then that would be bad.
Specifically metals
and things
Bethlehem?
Like that.
Yes.
Yeah, and they take, it's not just Bethlehem, they take...
But there's plenty of data to back that
stuff
up.
And they must test it.
I'm sure if we talk to Sheila, she would have recommendations for us as well to help us out. So, because I'm sure she would have access to records or be able to
They've actually provided records to me, and I've discussed it with another treatment plant operator that takes it currently. So,
I would hope that leachate gets a little bit broader testing than just regular wastewater.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, because there's potential for so many more things to be in it.
Mm. Yep. So those are other components that will be potentially fall into play once the new septage receiving is in operation, and we can potentially reevaluate the fees at that time, potentially with specific contracts or over a broader range with the general fees we charge.
Excellent.
And we can evaluate, now that we've had a thorough review and we're doing the rules and regulations or the ordinance, whichever term you want to use, the board can adopt, can amend this at any meeting.
Yes.
Right.
Yeah, the market will change, and we will review this.
Keep it current instead of waiting.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, we are investing a fair amount, significant money into upgrading our receiving, so that's $1 million. So we have to be
cognizant of that.
Well, we need to be, it's a business. We need to be, we need to keep the...
And in looking at 2015 revenues from septage alone, if you calculate the actual gallons we received from towns with agreements and gallons received without agreements, most of them most of the septage we received was towns with agreements.
With agreements, right.
The average cost for a gallon of septage coming in, or average cost that we charged, was actually 0.072 cents per gallon. So that shows you right there, it's mostly...
Right, exactly.
On the agreement side. Yeah.
Yep.
That makes sense.
Yes.
That makes sense. All right.
Okay.
So we'll put this on the agenda again for adoption?
Yeah.
In 2 weeks?
2 weeks, okay. When Steve is here next.
Yep, let's hope. So we can keep talking about the budget.
Awesome.
Yep.
So nothing else with that?
Nothing else with that.
All right, so...
Yeah, I didn't even...
Flip pages?
Yeah, on the water, but I'll assume that this is less...
Yeah, it's less tricky.
Right.
Less complicated.
Right.
Any other old business?
Oh, back to that, yes.
All right, other business, water test results. I'm assuming Jason is going to tell us about this too.
Yeah, there's actually two. There's a good news and a...
So we had been approached by New Hampshire Department of Environmental Services to voluntarily test for PFOA. PFOS.
I was wondering right. what promoted this test. Yeah.
PFOA.
So, which is what the issue is in Merrimack and down south.
Right.
And we tested for the full array of perfluorinated.
All of the nasty
compounds.
Yep.
And every compound that we tested for came back non-detect, which was below detection limit.
That's awesome.
So
no
good
PFOA, bill of health. No PFOS, no PF periods.
Correct.
Excellent. So what's the other news?
Good bill of health there.
Today we have other news.
On the same topic, when we put the well 1 and well 2 back into commission, we had to test for a full array of materials. And we did receive a detection and maximum contaminant level MCL violation for combined radium 226 and 228.
Oh,
that's
so those are a little radioactive doojiggers. So that's probably just the rock that the water is flowing through.
Right, it's natural.
It's the natural.
But we haven't had...
We never actually, in
my records, going back in DES records about 6 years, we haven't tested for this. So what I discussed with DES was that it was potentially before the time records were kept online that we had actually tested for this.
Okay.
And they were looking at our history, and our history is... not non-detect for this,
okay,
these compounds.
Do you think it was just because it got shaken up and we'll do a retest on it?
So well number one tested at 2.2 picocuries per liter,
which is super low, right? Go ahead.
And well number two tested at 5.5 picocuries per liter.
All right, and what's
the MCL is 5.
All right, so we're just barely over
the detection limit. But when we retest, they're going to take the average, so the next test has to be low.
Right, so they're going to take the average between this test and the next one.
Okay.
Well, further running of the well and
probably cleaned it out, I would think, as well.
Mm.
Yeah.
Just because it's been kind of sitting down.
How long
in there.
Had the well been back online when the test was done? Or was it...
Yep, well number two had been back online probably for a month. Well number one had been back online for probably a month.
Mm-hmm.
And
so
then
it should have been enough time.
Right.
But this is also well number two
right.
that had the problem.
Mm-hmm.
And it's tested at the well source. It's not tested, right?
Right, it's at tap, so it is treated. Yeah.
And it's going to be retested next week, you said?
Right, we have a confirmation sample where we... have a bottle order out right now, and we're hoping to test on Tuesday of next week.
Okay.
And there was no requirement for public notification of this.
Okay.
Because of the history of not having
it. Not having it.
And they're going to wait till the confirmation sample.
Okay.
So that we don't alarm anyone. It could be potentially a fluke.
There's always
a fluke.
Yeah. When you're dealing with such low levels, there's always the possibility that there was a lab error too.
Correct.
It's possible.
Yeah, yeah, they tested, I believe, 8 days after we had sampled for this contaminant, and this was actually a subcontracted lab from our vendor that we use. So this is something that was sent off after our lab had received it to another lab that tested for it. So there is always potential there.
It sounds like, yeah.
Are we going back to our regular lab for the retest?
Yes.
Eastern?
Yep.
Eastern Analytics does, yes, all our stuff?
Yep.
Okay. And Mel, you had some information about adoption of new regs?
I did.
Oh, yeah.
I believe that the answer to the question we asked last March about the process of adopting new rules and regulations or ordinances is finally settled. We have authority under the 1963 sewer regulation for the commissioners to adopt rules and regulations, or ordinance, it actually says. We'll have to get our semantics straightened out.
Yes.
And RSA 3826 authorizes municipal water works
departments
to adopt rules and regulations for a water district.
Awesome. So we're covered.
So, yes, we are covered. We would do this anyway, but the attorney reminded us to just to be fully transparent in terms of, we probably want to pose it at a hearing, post the hearing, put it on TV, do the normal things we would do,
mm-hmm,
but it doesn't have to go to a warrant.
Okay,
or
that's excellent.
But we could have copies around at
right.
that point,
that
all of that transparency, which I'm fully in favor of, but sort of an administrative happy time to be able to do it that way. So,
okay.
Jason's comments are into the attorneys that are working on this, and I also want to remind us that rules and regs rewrite is a courtesy of our current attorney at no cost, because she had some scheduling difficulties in the last year that created delays in things, so she's doing this as a favor, and she has a new associate.
Nice.
And she wants to break in this way. So.
And I'll be meeting with them on November 4th.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
So that's in motion. So I just wanted to say that out loud, because
okay.
it's been confusing
good.
Getting.
All righty. So then we have purchase reps.
Yeah, we have our purchase
orders. Unless anybody's got any others.
I think we've wrapped up the others.
All right. So we have 12 POs. So $800 to Eastern Analytical for our PFOA testing, $1,266.78 payable to AAA Pump Services for valves and for pump station 3. I like decimals rather than commas. That was scary. $523.88 to power up generator to troubleshoot the
pump station 8
generator.
Hope they fixed it.
I was going to say that. $42.60 for Solenis for polymer. $1,743.75 to Eastern Pipe to Camera South Main.
As discussed
previously. $766 to Eastern Analytical to test wells 1 and 2. $31.83.43 to Aramark for uniforms. $68.10 for a previously authorized PO payable to Bemis Utilities. The new total is $566.10.
Right, because I had signed the $400 and whatever it was.
Okay, so we just need to add it.
Yeah.
Okay.
PO in the amount of $1,329 to our website host, Jeff DeMora.
Mm-hmm.
$507 payable to Northeast New England Environmental for pump tubing, or Northeast Environmental?
New England, yeah.
New England.
Okay. $3,650 to Merrimack Sheet Metal for stairs for well 2, and $1,550 to Lamprey Septic to pump station 3.
Well, we did a repair.
Okay.
You had to
and
get all the stuff out.
That's all of them. I need a motion.
I will provide a motion. I'll make a motion that we approve the purchase recs by consent agenda.
And I will second that. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. And while we're signing, our next meeting dates are November 8th, 22nd, and December 6th.
Yeah. And while you're signing also, this isn't on the agenda, but do you want to tell them about the current lime silo problem?
Oh, yeah, that's good.
No, we don't want to hear it.
It's...
No more lime silo issues.
No.
Go ahead, Jason.
We had...
Don't go in there if you don't have to.
Yeah, please don't go in there.
We had Found out last week our lime silo had stopped working again. And upon going into the silo, we found the actual bin activator had broken off the cone and was vibrating around the silo until it ripped itself off the wires.
And, this is not a good sign.
And we called up Merrimack Sheet Metal and had them come up to re-weld the bracket to the cone. And we made for it to be mounted in the vertical position rather than the horizontal position.
Yeah. As long as we were
ripped itself off,
might as well mount it the way it was supposed to be mounted in the first time.
So we bolted that up today.
We didn't have to take it apart.
And rewired it and hope to be running it in the vertical position tomorrow. We initially turned it on today to test it, and we didn't even hear it, didn't even know it was on, and it was actually vibrating the cone.
Wow.
Whereas before, it shook the whole entire place.
Now, Jason, how do you guys just put the lime in when it's broken for several days?
We don't.
Should I ask? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
We have a contract with RMI.
He goes and he shovels it in.
We have a contract with RMI to be able to take raw biosolids untreated biosolids.
Yeah, because it can't go through the press or anything without
the lime.
Well, no, it does. It goes through the press and it's mixed with the lime after the press.
Oh, okay.
So we actually do press the solids to the dryness, but it doesn't get stabilized, the lime.
Oh, right, because the lime is as it's getting dumped into the truck.
Yes.
Right.
I remember afterwards.
RMI treats it on site. They dump it at their facility and have to hold it there for a certain amount of days and treat it with lime on their own. So that is an added cost to us, but it does allow us flexibility to repair it.
Yeah, to be able to fix things.
It sounds like this is abundantly good that
it tore itself to bits.
The motor is now back in its proper position. It certainly buys us
time.
We hope.
Yeah.
And we're also working with Merrimack Sheet Metal potentially to come up with an alternate proposal. Wright Pierce had their proposal to replace the entire cone from the manufacturer.
Right.
So we're working with them potentially to come up with an alternate proposal.
For
them to rebuild the cone.
Can stay. It's just the internal guts of the silo that are
a tiny little piece.
Essentially a 5-foot diameter cone at the very bottom. Sits on the upper portion of the hopper with a rubber gasket, and this vibrating mechanism shakes the cone so that it doesn't bridge the lime, so it keeps it in the conveyor going.
So if you were to imagine this, it's like a funnel, and the stuff is getting stuck in the funnel so that the funnel doesn't get stuck. It shakes a little and keeps it so that the stuff is flowing out of the funnel.
Yeah, an old-fashioned flour sifter.
Yes, an old-fashioned flour sifter, exactly. So where's the giant with the hand going like this to shift?
We joked around we'd have to have someone up there with a gong to hit the cone every 5 minutes.
On the hour. So that'd be our clock, the town clock.
There you go. Every time rounds bings, you got to go.
Oh, it's 12. There's the lime silo.
In another minor matter, the treasurer was good enough to supply us with deeds of our property along the river.
Okay. Excellent.
South of Bridge Street. So I want to read
those,
them,
and then Jason
can
talk about.
Yeah.
Okay. So
and having the deeds doesn't put it on the ground either. Without, we might be able to measure some things, but it's good to have these. She was great about getting them.
Okay. Is there anything else?
Yep. A few signatures. No.
All right. Well, I make a motion we adjourn after you're done signing.
Okay.